Right. Hello, everybody. I'm Ioannis Kosmidis, so all my contact details are here. Nothing exciting, it's just my initial and my surname, except for my Twitter account, which has an underscore. So if you forget this underscore, you will follow an ophthalmologist, which most probably is more useful than me, but anyway. CRAN is pretty big nowadays. So it has around 20,000 authors, more than 20,000 authors, contributing in 14.5K packages, roughly. This size comes with a lot of opportunity. So it's a rich and diverse software ecosystem. So we discussed yesterday the Software Heritage Project that can help quite a lot in software development. But it's also a very large database of authors, tools, and knowledge, which are very naturally linked to each other. So, for example, I'm the editor of three journals in statistics, and I spent quite a lot of time going through CRAN to see what people have done in order to find, for example, referees or experts to help the editorial process. Or even in my research, I look at the packages, what they are doing in order to learn stuff. So it's not uncommon that people publish a package before the paper. So it's a quite motivating environment. However, all this comes at a cost. It's quite hard to explore and keep track of. And this is what I would like to focus on today. So there are some solutions out there. So there is Dirk's Cranberries website, which does a fantastic job in aggregating information about new packages and old packages and putting in them in structured format and providing a feed to the user. There is CranLogs by Xadi, which is an API for downloads of packages. You have MetaCRAN, which is a very rich web interface to explore CRAN. There is a signing app which appeared a few months ago called CRAN Explorer by Stefan Sleeps, which is quite a very nice piece of software, as is CRAN Searcher, which is an R package which provides a signing app to explore CRAN. And then RW Search is a new R package, but Patrice will speak about this later, so I won't say anything. The game changer for these services was a function that appeared in R 3.4.0, and this function is here. So there is quite a lot of news, blah, blah, blah. And then you get to this function, which is CRAN Packets DB. So basically what it does, it dumps information from all the description files into a single data frame. And I will tell a bit more about this in the next few slides. So what it does is basically reads all the description files and puts them in a structured data frame, which is full of character strings. So it's not a very nice object to work with, but all the information is in there, right? So the command is here, it's CRAN Packets DB, basically, and it will download this file for you if you do it. If there are all these solutions, why bother make CRANly, really, which is the package I'm talking about? So I had like scientific reasons for that. So CRAN is a network not only physically, like us here, or digitally, like what you see when you go to cran.rproject.org, but it's also a network mathematically. It's a formal mathematical network. And I would like really to explore this formal mathematical network in order to discover and understand the interconnections in CRAN and how they form. And also because of my research interest of modeling of software networks in particular. And then I had less altruistic reasons. I told you about one of those, so finding referees, which is a never-ending process nowadays. Do what is at my website. So if you click, you will see what is in there. And also keep track of who, why, and what links to my R packages that I maintain. So this is why I bothered, basically, last year to make it. So CRANly has a very lean interface. I like lean interfaces. So there are like six main functions, really, and various extractor functions, which I'm going to talk about it. So basically, it has a workflow. So first, you get the data frame, you clean it up, and I will say a bit about this. Then you build networks out of it. You can build dependence trees out of it. You can calculate all sorts of summaries, and then you have a general plot method for everything. So I will explain a bit more about this. But the interface is this slide, really. So how does a description file look like? So I'm sure you have all seen description files. So the font is very small here, but what I would like you to focus on perhaps is that you get a title, you get the version, a description, you get the authors, the maintainer, which is only one, license, and all sorts of other fields describing attributes of the R packets, right? And this CRAN packet DB extracts all this information from any single description file and puts them in a data frame. A very important part of the description file are the packet directives. So basically, these are fields explaining to what other packages your packets connects to, or what other packages connect to your packets, and how. Right? So for example, here I have lubridates. Directive. So, for example, it suggests test.dat, netar, and covar. It depends on methods and tar, and so on and so forth. All these links, though, this brings me back to my point of a mathematical object, define a network. So, it tells you how all packages in CRAN link to each other. So, packages are nodes, and then you form edges according to the directives. Also, you have an author collaboration network in the description, from the description file. So basically, this again from the lubridate R packet. So you can see like all the authors and contributors in the author field. And basically, this is a small social network, right? So all these people are linked to each other through these packets. So you can imagine like people being nodes and then edges being formed depending on what packets they collaborated on. And all the description files, if I would get all the author fields from all description files, then I would have the whole CRAN collaboration network, which is a massive object. So I said something about cleaning up the description files. So we need a systematic way of extracting packets and author names from description. So just to give you an example, here is a very complicated author field. So this is of a packet which I won't name, but you see that you have like the author names, but you have a lot of free text involved here. So you have with co-authors wrote on original calls under some guidance, blah, blah, blah. So this is bad practice, of course, but it happens quite a lot in CRAN because there's no control of what goes in the author field. You even have the queen in the right of Canada being a copyright holder in various packages, which is quite amusing, actually. So we need to clean all this if we need to form the nodes, right? Because we need the names. We don't need all this extra text. So Cranly provides a cleanup author function, which is a kind of a structured, quite complex regex exercise, which basically can take all these input strings and output things that you care about. So, for example, if you clean up the author for this very big author field I gave you, you just get the names. Or, for example, you can kill the queen. Oops. So, sorry, you can remove the queen by simple regex, right? So you get the only author in this field. You can do the same with the packages, because usually in the packets field, you get like a lot of information about the version of the package, which is already extracted anyway. So we don't need that, and you can very quickly clean it up with cleanup directives here. All right, and then there is a wrapper, which is called CleanCRANDB, which does all these operations for you and a bit more to put this data frame in a format that you can work with, basically, for modeling purposes and summarizing it. This is the CRANLYDB object. So, for example, here I have the lubridate imports after cleaning up the CRANLY database, the CRAN database, and I get the authors again, so in a very clean format. All right, so now that we have cleaned the fields, we know what are the unique nodes in this mathematical object I described, right? So I want to go through this CRANLY network concept. So, there is one function that does all this. It's called build network, and it organizes the information in this cleaned data frame in networks objects. But you have two perspectives, right? So you have like the author perspective and you have the package perspective. The author perspective is authors being connected according to what packages they collaborate, and the package perspective is packages being connected according to how they link to each other. Okay? And The perspective author defines an author collaboration network. Nodes are authors. Edge is formed by being in the same author field. And the package directives networks, I just said how it's formed, using directive fields. So the interface is very simple. So you just do build network, the clean package database, perspective package, or perspective author, and you will get two objects, which are lists of two data frames. One data frame is the edges, and the other data frame is the nodes. And they have exactly the same structure, these two objects. And one cool thing is that you can interrogate them with some sort of literate programming extractor. So for example, I can use the package network and then extract the authors of data table from it. So by simply saying author of data table, I can do the version of dplyr. Of course, here you get a lot of versions simply because this matching is not exact, right? So there are a lot of packages that have dplyr in their name. And so you get the versions of all packages. You have the opportunity to also output data frames. There is a flat argument there, which will give you more information about all the packages. This is all packages with the name tracker in them. For example, I can search all the fellow Greeks that are called Ioannis in Cran. So there are only three, which is surprising because it's the most common Greek name. The maintainer of color space is Achim. These are my packages, so package by will give you all the packages by a certain name, matching the name characters. You can get titles. I can see all the emails of maintainers that work at the same institution as me, like Warwick here, right? So Heather Turner is also should be also in that list, but she has a different email address. So, so you can extract all this information from the networks in a very clean and lean interface. There was supposed to be a histogram here, but for some reason there is not. So basically, this is all the release dates of the R packages currently in CRAN. This histogram should be extremely left skewed. So basically, you would have like all the concentration of mass very close to today. And actually, this is a sign of a healthy ecosystem, right? So. An unhealthy ecosystem should have a more symmetric distribution. So this means that it died off. So you need left skew distributions and exponential decaying left tail to get a healthy ecosystem. Sorry, the histogram didn't appear here. Right, so how do we visualize them? So visualization is very simple. So what I do here, I'm plotting the package networks. Just restricting everything to my packages. So author is equal to Ioannis Kosmidis. And you get an interactive network that you can scroll and interrogate. So here's in Cranly, and then you get some MetaCran information from this as a quick information. So this helps me quite a lot. If I want to search somebody's activity in Cran, I do that, and then I can see all sorts of information by simply hovering over the nodes. So, for example, the colors of the arrows have a meaning. So this is, for example, is imported by. So this means that ggplot2 is imported by Cranly, right? So it's a citation network, but in the reverse order, the way we visualize it here. You can also visualize. You can also visualize author network. So this is the author network of Brian Ripley. So a very prolific programmer, an influential programmer in R. So if I zoom in, you can start seeing names that you possibly recognize. So here's Hinman. If I hover on top of it, you can see like some information about Brian Ripley, who had 562 collaborators in 41 packages, right? So this is impressive. So you can do more. So you can do summary. So as I said, my aim was modeling, so having a clean mathematical object that I can use for modeling. So you can do all sorts of summaries by simply using the summary method. So just to show you, again, there were two plots here, but for some reason they don't come up in this laptop. So what you have is basically here you would have like a top 20 list of people according to the number of packages they have. So RStudio is first, Hadley is second. Then we have RCore, and then there is all sorts of people. I think Achim is there, JJ Aller is there, and so on. And here you have also the optional packages by and imported by. Sorry, these graphics don't appear here. You can also do more. So one thing that I have implemented, once I have constructed a mathematical object, I can do all sorts of very nice analysis with it. So I can use like a very neat recursion. So it's really two lines of code, it's a recursion, to construct all the dependence tree of an R package. So basically starting from the R package up to the base R, how do the dependencies evolve, right? And then on top of that, you can define a package dependence index, which is basically a weighted average of the generation of a package, weighted by how many times is being imported or linked by other packages, because the number of links and dependencies is a good indicator of stability, in a sense. So this was also an exercise for me to keep track of my own packages, because you would like to have packages that don't have many dependencies, right? So there's a very good argument to be made that the more dependencies you have in an R package, the more unstable it is potentially in the future, because some dependency might change, right? And this package dependency index will be very large if you have this. So it looks like this. So for example, here's the package dependency tree of Tibble. So you can see like generations of packages. So Tibble is generation zero. So Tibble is generation zero. Then you have generation one, like package config, which is immediate dependence. Then you have generation minus two, and you work down your way to the base R. So you see everything and how the package depends on everything else. Right, so I've done all this. So current work, we work quite a lot in statistical models for software networks now, having Cranly in place. Modeling of dependence tree is a very active area in my group. And we do some topic analysis. So I have like five students working with me on these projects. We are planning to issue a sign interface, though this is not a high priority thing, and also license compatibility checks for our packages. So thank you very much.